Hello, my name is Kyle Utterback. I'm the worship pastor here at Crossroads Church, and I'd just love to welcome you guys today. It's great to see you here at our 10:45 service, and today we're going to be celebrating Easter. The Lord is risen, and it's a cause for celebration. He casted off the chains of death and sin and shame, and today we're going to celebrate that. So if you'd stand with me, I'm going to pray real quick, and then we're going to start song one. All right. Jesus, we thank you today. We thank you for the sacrifice that you made on Friday and that you rose again on Sunday and that through you we can have eternal life. And I would ask that you'd be here in this service and that our eyes would be on you and not on the cool stuff that we have going on stage here, and that it would just be focused to you and that these songs would be a tool so that people can learn more about who you are in their life. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, we're going to start singing here. Whoa, whoa.
Shame is gone. You won't be shackled to the way I was. I'm gonna live like my chains are gone. Gone. Now my sin is dead, gone, and I sing hallelujah. Done. Done. He is risen, it is done, and I sing hallelujah. Praise is a weapon that'll overcome. I'm gonna shout like the battle's won. Fall back, devil, 'cause your time is up. I'm gonna live like the stone is gone. Gone. Now my sin is dead. Oh, saw Satan fall like lightning. I saw darkness run for cover. But the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. I believe in signs and wonders. I have resurrection power. Still the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. My praise belongs to you forever. Whoa. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. Come together, sons and daughters, bought with blood and washed in water. Sing the praises of the Spirit, Son and Father. Our God will finish what He started. Our God will finish what He started. This is my testimony. From death to life, 'cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, then you're not done. Hey, baby. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story. I'm testified by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony. Oh, I'm alive. This is my testimony. From death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story. I'm justified by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. Almighty reigns. Alleluia.
darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Praise our Father, praise our Son, praise our Spirit, free in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. To reveal the kingdom coming, and to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation, you did not despise the cross. For even in your suffering, you saw to the other side, knowing this was your salvation, Jesus for our sake you died.
Dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who'd come to the Father are restored. And the Church of Christ was born, then the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not fade. By His blood, thank you.
nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus.
Lord, we just praise your name this morning. Hallelujah. Lord, we just love you. What a beautiful, beautiful, powerful name you have. Father, we just thank you for dying on the cross for us. Lord, we just honor your name this morning. We praise your name. Thank you for coming alive in our spirit today, Father, and just be with us as we go today. In these things we pray.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. John 3:16 is for the whoever's. Wherever you came from, whatever you've done, and whoever you are, I want you to know that according to John 3:16, right now you have an arms wide open welcome from God. Anybody, everybody, anywhere, whoever. John 3:16 isn't just for kids. It's for hurting mothers, broken fathers, and all of us. It isn't just for t-shirts and tattoos and bumper stickers and bookmarks. Because John 3:16 is not a decoration. It's a declaration. John 3:16 is an invitation to redemption, reconciliation, forgiveness, and eternal life. John 3:16 reminds us that the story of God isn't about a few special people making it up to God, but God making his way down to the rest of us, to the whoever's. John 3:16 is what God thinks about you. You are loved, welcomed, valued, seen, and you are invited. You are not half-loved, you are not unseen, and you are not forgotten. John 3:16 is for the whoever's. John 3:16 is for you. John 3:16 is for me.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Mark. I'm the lead pastor. I'm so glad that you guys have joined us on Easter. He is risen. There you guys go. Let's try that one more time. He is risen. Well, we are worship a risen Savior this morning. What a joy that is. If you're new, we would love to connect with you. You can see there we have a welcome packet that you could get some more information about our church, or you can also fill out a connect card. You can see the QR code right up here on the screen. I'll leave that up here for a minute, and then you could just take your phone out, open up your camera app, and then like scan that. Oh, look at it. It popped right up. And then you can open it up right to the Connect card, and it opened up right there. That's pretty nice. So you could do that digitally on your smartphone, or you could, on the back of the chairs, you can use like the old school, like a way to fill out a Connect card and fill that out and drop it off in the offering basket as it goes by, or you can also drop it off over in on our lobby outside there. I see someone trying to do that. So keep working on that. Leave that up just for a second. Get more here, so but we would love to connect with you. You can submit a prayer request that way as well, and I would love to pray over that. And I know our prayer team does that every Wednesday. So what a joy it is to pray for you guys and lift you up in that way. The next thing I want to mention is our bed bill that we have with Sleep and Heavenly Peace. So on Saturday, a lot of people, over 30 plus people, gave their time and their talents. I don't have very much talents when it comes to building things, but I at least got in there and helped. And what a joy it is as Sleep and Heavenly Peace really wants to provide beds for kids who don't have beds here in our county. And we were able to help in this way. Crossroads here contributed toward 12 beds, which was about $3,000. And then Sleep in Heavenly Peace contributed the lumber and the supplies for 8. And then we were able to put together, that's 20 beds. I hear that's the most that they've ever done in a bed bill day. So, well, how awesome is that? Praise the Lord that we're able to be the hands and feet of Jesus. Yeah, it amazes me. On Christmas Eve, Andre and I were up late building a bunk bed for Joelle and Margot, and that we, you know, just to think that there's kids in our county that don't have a bed, and just I'm just thankful that we're able to participate in that. The next thing I wanted to mention here is put up on the slide. Thank you. I forgot for a second. Our new series coming up, In His Name. So actually, it's starting today. So In His Name, when you think about, we want to be reminded of who God is, who Jesus is. And this morning, we're going to look at the Lamb and the Good Shepherd and how Jesus is those things. He is the Lamb that gave his life for us. He is our Good Shepherd. And I really feel like this goes really well with Good Friday and Easter, this Easter weekend that we are in right now. So I want to encourage you to participate. This is a series also about just depression and anxiety and the stresses and that we can face in this world, and especially over the last few years, we all need to be reminded of who God is, and then especially if we're dealing with depression, anxiety, those kinds of things, this is hopefully comforting and healing for you. And then if you know people, invite them to come, to be a part, or even just to hopefully this gives you tools too on how to be with those, and not just not quick fix answers to their issues, but to really walk with people through the darkness and into light. And I want to also mention, too, some of our life groups are going to be doing this series, Mine, that Andre and I lead on Sunday nights. We'll be doing that, and some other groups go through the sermons and the discussions like that. But some of them will, some of them don't. But at the very least, our life groups really are about community, being there for each other. I want to encourage you to check. There's an iPad out here, out in our lobby, that you can look at the life groups that we have available. You can sign up digitally right there on the iPad, but or you can also, there's a paper sign up where you can sign up that if you're interested in that. Now is the time to jump into community, to be there for each other, especially over the last few years. We all need each other. So with that, let's go into a time of offering. Thank you once again for giving sacrificially. The bed build, you know, you guys helped with that with $3,000 that helped to build 12 beds. So thank you so much for giving generously. And you can give on our website. You can give cash or check. You can also give as the offering baskets go by. You can drop your offering in there, or you can give out in our lobby here this morning. There's giving boxes out there. But let me pray for us right now. Father, I am thankful for your faithfulness. Thank you for what a great, we had a great first service, and this is, thank you for your presence being here for this second service as well. Be with us here this morning, and yeah, we just are thankful for how you are faithful. Bless this offering, bless our church family here, bless these people individually. May this offering also go forth to fulfill the mission that you've given Crossroads Church, and we ask these things in Jesus' name, amen.
Saturday was silent, surely it was through. But since when has impossible ever stopped me? Friday's disappointment is Sunday's empty tomb. But since when has impossible ever stopped me? This is the sound of dry bones rattling. This is the praise make a dead man walk again. Open the grave, I'm coming out. I'm gonna live again. This is the sound of dry bones rattling.
Go ahead and stand with us.
A Pentecostal fire stirring something new. You're not gonna run out of miracles anytime soon. The resurrection power runs in my veins too. I believe there's another miracle here in this room. This is the sound of dry bones rattling. This is the praise, make a dead man walk again. Open the grave, I'm coming out. I'm gonna live again. This is the sound of dry bones rattling. Oh.
My God is able to save and deliver and heal and restore anything that he wants to. Just ask the man who was thrown on the bones of Elisha if there's anything that he can do. Just ask the stone that was rolled at the tomb in the garden what happens when God says to move. I feel him moving now. I feel him moving now. I feel him doing it now. Do it now. Do it now. This is the sound of dry bones rattling. This is the praise, make a dead man walk again. Open the grave, I'm calling out. I'm gonna live again. Open the grave, I'm coming out. I'm gonna live again. Open the grave, I'm coming out. I'm gonna live again. This is the sound of dry bones rattling.
Amen. You may be seated. Wow, we can definitely almost end the service on that note. That was great. But yeah, I want to preach this morning, Easter Sunday. I'm the lead pastor here, and we're starting a new series, as I mentioned earlier, and that series is In His Names. And this morning, we're going to be looking at the Lamb and the Good Shepherd. The Lamb and the Good Shepherd. Jesus is that Lamb of God. As in John's account of the life of Jesus, John, he shares about John the Baptist seeing Jesus coming, and he says, "Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Look, behold, here's the Lamb of God. He takes away our sins. He's that sacrificial lamb." we read on our Good Friday service in Isaiah, the suffering servant. In Isaiah chapter 53 says, he was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before its shears is silent, so he did not open his mouth. He was assigned a grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, though he had no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him and cause him to suffer. Jesus is that sacrificial lamb who takes away our sins, the sins of the world, and those who have placed their trust in Jesus. Jesus has paid the price for our sins, the penalty for our sins, and we are freed from the power and the penalty of our sins. And yet, Jesus, he lays down his life freely. He says, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. And in John 10, 17, Jesus, he says, the reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This commandment I have received from my Father. Jesus has that authority to lay his life down. He has that authority to take up his life. And we know that is the case because we are all here to remember and celebrate that he is alive. In Luke's account of the resurrection, we can read here in Luke 23. Let me turn, or 24. Let me turn there here this morning. In verse 1, he says, on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women, they took spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the woman bowed down with their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee, the Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners and be crucified and on the third day be raised again." Then he remembered, they remembered his words. He is risen. He is risen indeed. This is why we're here. This is what we're celebrating. What a great weekend we've had, as we've been talking about with Good Friday, the bed build, and Easter. What a great way to start off this Easter Sunday this morning to look at who Jesus is. As I mentioned earlier, we're starting this series in his names, looking at the names of Jesus. And one of the things that I want to be real with and notice is while this is really exciting, and even this is my first Easter here as a lead pastor, and that is also I'm blessed to be able to be here. But yet, at the same time, many of us are struggling or know people who are struggling. There's depression and anxiety and stresses that we can face, pressures in our lives. Whether it's you or you know somebody, it can be really hard. Or maybe you knew somebody who said, "Oh, I'm going to come this morning," and they didn't come. Maybe it's hard for them to even get out of bed in the morning. It's been a rough 2.5+ years for us, for this country, for the world even. And then this depression and anxiety is on the rise. And that's why we're starting this series this morning, looking at the names of Jesus and then seeing how his names, remembering who he is, can bring healing to our lives and even to help us if we're struggling, or even to give us tools on how to help people who we know are struggling in our lives. Now, Barna Research, they talk about some of the struggles that young people have been facing over the last few years. They say that there's an internal and external pressures that they deal with. So they could be afraid to fail. They could be anxious about important decisions, uncertain about the future, pressure to be successful, or external pressures such as being judged by older generations or pressured by parents' expectations. But one thing, as we look at internal and external pressures, we, all the generations, are feeling these things as we have pressure to be a good parent or a good spouse or to get, you know, do our job and to juggle everything that we have to deal with, or even just the everyday stuff of life. But then when our rhythms get interrupted by tragedy, by sickness, by chronic illness, by depression, anxiety, and addictions and sin, then things can snowball in a lot of ways. Pew Research, they talk about about halfway through the pandemic, they did some research, and you could see here about 1/3 of U.S. adults report at least occasional sleeplessness, anxiety in the past week. So occasionally could be, or moderate could be, 3 to 4 days where people are dealing with sleeplessness and anxiety, and it's rough. We need a good night's sleep, and when you don't get that over multiple days or multiple weeks and months, that's where we can get weak, where we can feel anxious, we can feel stressed, we can then lash out and say and do things that we wish we didn't. We can start destructive behavior that can lead us away from what God would have us in our lives. This is real. None of us really are exempt, whether we've been a Christian for a few months or for 20, 30 years, whether we're a volunteer as a Sunday school teacher, whether we're a pastor, an elder, a deacon. All of us can face these kind of realities of depression and anxiety and stress. There's a woman, Janita Pace, who I know really well, her and her husband, Tim. Tim Pace was a pastor at a church that I was at previous to here. Great people. I actually went to a Twins Dodger game up in Minneapolis. It was really cold last week, but went and got to see Tim. It was good to catch up a little bit. But Janita and Tim, they have this powerful testimony that I want us to watch here, and then I'll talk a little bit about it after this video.
And when I was in my final year in college at Columbia International University, I was studying the Bible. My husband was a pastor. We were living the ministry life. I began to have really, it was really hard to get up in the morning. I was foggy. I was full of sadness, hopeless, feeling depressed, feeling heavy. My body felt heavy. And I began to really struggle to go places. And as it got harder and harder, the guilt and the shame and the thoughts of, you should be an active pastor's wife. You know, you're a Christian. You should feel joy. You should feel happiness. So lots of very shame-based thoughts, which made it worse, which made it harder. And the more I hid in isolation, the worse it got. And I put pressure on Tim, my husband, as a pastor, to keep it quiet, because I felt that was evidence then that we weren't spiritual enough. And so, you know, in that environment that I put myself in, that I found myself in, I became convinced of a lie that Tim could do ministry better without me, and that the world would actually do better without me, that I had stopped giving to the Christian society, that I had stopped being worthy. And so I remember so well the day that I just made the decision that I would end my life. And Tim was going to work, and I had already decided that after he left that I would commit suicide. And so he left for work, and I was kind of getting things organized and arranged, and I had planned on overdosing, and he forgot something. Mm-hmm. And he came home and he walked in on, you know, me preparing a few things. And it was just, I mean, you talk about broken. We both cried. It was so overwhelming. And he took me to a psychiatric hospital. And that was the scariest experience that I've ever had. I still, even this many years later, can go back and think about how scary that was. And for anyone who's been in that position, you think about you lose all of your freedom. You go in, and I know they were doing what they needed to do, so I'm not judging the decision.
Sure.
But I, you know, they take everything away and they isolate you in order to just try to get, you know, get you centered, get you some support. They did allow me to have my Bible. So once Tim left, I was not allowed to speak to my family. They wanted me to go to an intensive therapy program. And it was one of the situations, I think I've talked to so many Christians that can relate to this, where you're so desperate. You're just flipping through the scriptures. You don't even know what to read.
Yeah.
And I stumbled on Psalm 121, which talks about how God watches over us while we sleep. And we look to the hills, and where does our help come from? It's a very desperate psalm. And it ends by saying, you know, that we look to God. And I started reading that over and over. I couldn't sleep at night, so I'd read it. I would get scared, and I would read it. I just clung to it. And so when I finally got out of the hospital, got home, and I had a bunch of voicemails from different people, and one of them was from Steve Bradley, who was one of our professors, and he said, Janita, I couldn't sleep last night, and I just felt like I should read this to you. I know that you're in the hospital, but when you get out, I hope you hear this. And he read Psalm 121. And it was such an incredible moment because it was just the confirmation that God hadn't left, because I thought maybe God had.
Yeah.
So he wanted me to meet his wife, and that was the last thing I wanted to do. I didn't want to meet anyone. But he had his wife come over. Her name was Pat. And Pat had been through depression on the mission field. And so while everyone, you know, a lot of people were offering advice and books and, you know, a lot of intellectual feedback, mm-hmm. Pat was offering very practical feedback, practical support, calling me in the morning, are you up, are you okay, reminding mm-hmm. me that hope was not lost. She would say, I'll carry your hope for you until you can have it for yourself. And she would tell me over and over, God will use this, and I could not, that was way beyond what I could even comprehend. She started mentoring me, and about a month into our mentorship, she passed away very suddenly. Mm-hmm. And I got a phone call from Tim, and I was just devastated, and I decided to walk down to our mailbox to just kind of center myself because I was overwhelmed with that. And I found a card from her in my mailbox that she'd mailed the day before when she had passed away suddenly. And then it just said, God will use this and you'll see. And so
wow.
I didn't know what that meant, but it was really incredible. And I kept that and I held on to that and thought, okay, how is God going to use this? Because unfortunately, the people at our church didn't understand, and the elders came and instead of praying for us, talked to us about maybe we weren't fit for ministry and maybe I was living in sin and maybe there were things that weren't right with us. And so we did feel like, wow, maybe ministry is over and we're not capable anymore. But I had Pat's card remind me that that's not true.
All right, so there's that video from Janita, and what a powerful testimony from them. And just how God is continuing to use them, that she's a therapist now and helping people. Her husband's still a pastor in the Minneapolis area, and just how God worked in and through just a hard situation. But this is an example of, you know, none of us are exempt from this, and yet, but God wants to meet us in the darkness, bring us out of that. And she has a book called The Healing Names of Jesus, and you can see a copy of that. There's a few copies out there over by the coffee and the cookies area, and a powerful book, a devotional. My life group is going to go through it, and some other life groups are going to also discuss this sermon series that we're in. I want to encourage you to not, if you're struggling, to not do that alone, but to do that in community. But I also wanted to mention here this book called Fear Gone Wild, and this is by Kayla Stockline. And I have read this portion from this book a few months ago, but here her husband was struggling with panic attacks, anxiety, depression, and unfortunately in August 2018, he took his own life. But in April 2018, a few months before that, he was dealing with a lot of different things when it comes to panic attacks. And she writes in her book, on Easter weekend in April 2018, Andrew was on the church campus gearing up to speak for the first of seven services that would stretch over the course of 3 days. He had just returned home from a three-week trip in India and Uganda, a trip I had attempted to talk him out of, a trip that had already been postponed once due to Andrew's health complications. But he was passionate about the work our church was doing in India and excited about the potential connections to be made in Africa. He felt strongly that his presence on the trip was necessary. So I eventually accepted that there was nothing I could do to prevent him from going. When he returned, he was as exhausted as I expected. He was still suffering from panic attacks, fear, and anxiety. He was running on empty, but somehow would be able to give the Easter message. On the day of the first service, however, a security guard found Andrew curled up on the bathroom floor. He was hyperventilating so bad that he was starting to lose sensation in his hands and feet. The security guard called me and another family member, and we rushed to the office to help. I knew as soon as I locked eyes with Andrew that fear had taken hold. The same fear I had seen nearly every night for 6 long months. Out of control, untouchable, irrational, and terrifying fear gone wild. Andrew's eyes were glazed over, his pupils were dilated, and he was gone. I knew there wasn't much we could do to relieve his pain other than wait it out beside him. We prayed aloud, rubbed his back, and spoke truth over him. I was so relieved when miraculously the panic attack subsided, just in time for Andrew to be mic'd up and rushed onto the stage. As he began speaking to the church, I sat in the green room, surrounded by the band who had just finished their worship set, and broke into tears. I fell into the arms of the musicians and my friends and wept. Andrew was on stage speaking. I was backstage crying. And not a single person sitting in the sanctuary could have known anything was amiss. In my heart, it all felt so wrong. My faith was weary, and I thought, where are you, God? Why aren't you fixing this? Why does he continue to suffer? What am I supposed to do? Maybe you are struggling right now. Maybe you're dealing with various kinds of things, with depression, anxiety, panic attack. Once again, there's you could be a pastor's wife. You could be a pastor. You could be an elder, a deacon. You could be a Sunday school teacher, whatever it is, a missionary. All these things, we can face these kinds of troubles. And yet we can look at the names of Jesus. We can look and be reminded about who Jesus is and how he can step in and bring healing and hope to people who are hopeless. And if you're doing pretty good, praise the Lord for that. May this be a reminder to you of who Jesus is. But then may this series even help to give you tools on how to help people who are struggling. So we looked at Jesus as a sacrificial lamb for us. Now I want to look here at John chapter 10 as Jesus is the good shepherd. In John 10, therefore, Jesus said, very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who have come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep have not listened to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. They will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. So Jesus, he provides salvation and protection for his flock, for his people. He's the door, or he's the gate. People can come in his flock, and they come in and they can be safe. But he's also the door or the gate where the predators, the thieves, the robbers, the wolves, they are protected in the pen. And Jesus, he's really speaking to these religious leaders, the Pharisees, of these others that would steal, kill, and destroy. Ultimately, there's an evil one, the enemy, Satan, who wants to steal, kill, and destroy. You think of when we are struggling with depression or isolation, and we think, the world would be better off without me. That is the enemy. That is a lie, that you are valuable, that you are loved, you are someone that Jesus died for. And that is what Jesus offers to all of us here, to come in and to find salvation in his name. But yet others may come and steal, kill, and destroy. Jesus, he brings extraordinary life, life to the full, life now and forever, eternal life. Because ultimately we worship and we trust a living shepherd, one who has defeated death. He is risen. He has risen. Jesus, he continues, I am the good shepherd, and the good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep, so when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. Then the wolf attacks the flock and scatters. The man runs away because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. So the good shepherd, he lays down his life for his people, for his flock, for his sheep. And the hired hand does not do that, but he lays down his life for us as a sacrifice. But then we might think, well, what is a use of a dead shepherd? He lays down his life because a wolf comes or an enemy or whatever, but then what about other enemies, other wolves that might come? But as we've heard already this morning, we worship and we place our trust in a living shepherd who lays down his life. He freely gives it up, but then he takes it up again. Continuing on, Jesus says, I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep, and my sheep know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. So the shepherd and the sheep, their relationship is really intimate, close. The sheep know the voice of their shepherd. But here we see Jesus talking about how this relationship with the Father, we can see that Jesus knows you and you know him, just as he and the Father know each other. That's hard for my mind to even wrap my mind around this truth, and yet Jesus wants this kind of relationship with us, his sheep, that we can have this kind of relationship with him. So even in the midst of feeling isolated and alone and like we have no one in this world, we have a shepherd who wants to have this kind of relationship with you. So Jesus, he continues on, I have other sheep that are not of this sheep pen. I must bring them also. They too will listen to my voice, and there shall be one flock and one shepherd. The reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This command I've received from my Father. So Jesus is that good shepherd laying down his life, but then he takes it up. He has defeated death. He has defeated death. So whatever you're dealing with, whatever you're struggling with, we worship a living Savior that is active in our lives, that is present and walks with us through the good. He walks with by our side no matter what. Now I want to read for you guys this morning Psalm 23. This is a psalm of David, a king. He was a shepherd boy, but then he is the shepherd of God's people. But then he ultimately looks to the Lord as his shepherd. In Psalm 23, he says, "The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lay down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." So the Lord's goodness, the good shepherd's goodness and love and his extraordinary life follow us all the days of our lives. So that includes the days where we're beside quiet waters, where our souls are being restored. And then it includes the darkest days in the darkest valley. Our good shepherd is following us, and he has goodness and mercy and love. When we feel like we have no hope, he shows us hope. He pours it out on us. My big idea for us this morning is the good shepherd guides us with goodness, mercy, and extraordinary life. Whatever you're going through, wherever you're at in your faith journey, he has this for you all the days of your life. He is the good shepherd. I want to just also give you guys just some practical tips or resources, if you will. If you're struggling or you know somebody who's struggling, read Psalm 23. Read this psalm, or read Psalm 21, the psalm that Janita mentioned earlier. Read these, speak these over yourselves, speak this truth over you, and then ask yourself, how is Jesus your good shepherd in this psalm, in Psalm 23? And then what is your darkest valley? What are you going through? I don't know what that is. The Lord does. You could ask it, you know, bring those things to him, whether it's depression or anxiety or sin or addiction, whatever it might be. Bring those things to him. And then also be with people who you trust and talk with people who you trust. We all need each other. We are a new family. In the John passage we just read, that God was forming this new flock, really Israelites and non-Jewish people, bringing people together, a family together. That's what we are here, a family. We aren't meant to live in isolation or go through these things, especially the darkest valleys. So have those people that you trust. Be with those people who won't just have the quick fix answers, but will meet you in the darkest valley and walk with you through whatever you're going through. And also, one more time, just another kind of push toward be in community, be in life groups. You can look at that iPad out in our lobby and see the different groups that are available. And look at the resources, the books, the Healing Names of Jesus that Janita wrote, The Fear Gone Wild by Kayla Stockline, Hope in the Dark. There's plenty of opportunities to connect. I want to encourage you to do that. Excuse me. And also I want to mention, limit social media and news. We actually live in a blessed time where we can know what's going on in the world, and we can pray for people in Ukraine. We can pray for people around the world and be aware of things. But there's a limit to that. Ultimately, God is supposed to be all-knowing. We aren't supposed to be. We can be aware so we can praise, but we need to monitor that. A lot of anxiety and a lot of feeling overwhelmed could be with just spending a lot of time on these different platforms. I forgot to mention, drink less caffeine. That might be kind of a funny one, but even just a few weeks ago, I had like more caffeine than I normally did, and I felt like, I'm kind of anxious. My heart rate is up a little bit, and like, what is going on? I'm like, I went to Caribou and had an Americano that had like double the amount of caffeine that I normally have in a day. So those kind of things can happen, and we need to be careful with what we're consuming. And then also, it's okay to seek counseling. As Janita, she's a professional therapist, and she sought that. You know, I've even sought counseling over the years as well. There's nothing wrong with that, or pastoral counseling. If you need to talk with a pastor, I'm happy to talk with you with whatever you're going through in your life. Don't despair, don't doubt, don't struggle in isolation. Let's do this together as a forgiven family of God. And lastly, if you haven't placed your trust in Jesus, place your trust in a living Savior. He laid down his life as a sacrificial lamb for your sins. As you turn to him, place your trust in him, then your sins are forgiven. You're freed from the power and the penalty of sin. The wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. Place your trust in him, and he rose again on the third day to give you life now and forever. Let me pray for you. Father, I am thankful for this Easter. What a blessing it is to be able to worship you, to place our trust in you for sending your son Jesus as that sacrificial lamb who laid down his life for us. And yet he is the good shepherd that has taken up his life, that he is resurrected. He is risen, and we praise you for that. I pray for those in the room who are struggling that you would be with them. May they turn to you, turn to your word. And that to know that you meet them in the darkness, you meet them in the anxiety, you meet them in the isolation, and you pour out love and goodness and mercy and life into their lives. I pray that you would do that for them. Pour out your love and your kindness into their hearts. I pray for those in the room too who maybe don't know you, that they would turn to you. Oh, you love them so much. You have taken away their sins if they place their trust in you. Show them your love, your kindness. Give them that eternal life if they place their trust in you. I pray for all of us that we would walk with each other as a forgiven family through the good, through the darkest valley, that we would be there as your people. Watch over us. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, if you'd stand with us, we're going to sing one more song today. It's been a wonderful Easter, and we're so glad to see you guys here. And we hope that you have a good time, and we hope that we can see you again next Sunday. If you'd sing with me.
The splendor of the King, robed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice, it trembles at his voice. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God. Age to age he stands, and time is in. Beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? No, we'll see how great, how great.
All names,
you have the name above all names, worthy of all praise. And my heart will sing, how great is our God.
Name above all names,
you have the name above all. And all will sing how great is our God.
Amen.
How great is our God. Sing with me how great is our God. And all will sing how great
the best part.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, God, to be. How great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Amen.
Amen. The Apostle Paul, he says, Jesus, who being the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness and being found in appearance as a man. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place, gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. Have a great Easter, everybody.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to me. How great thou art.
You guys next week, 9:30. Thank you.